Welcome to worship. I am Pastor Rick. I am glad for this opportunity to be able to worship with you in this contemporary setting. Some of you may not have seen me before. I am one of the three pastors. I'm usually down at Melbourne Beach and doing the Melbourne Beach recordings. Before we begin, I want to make sure that you have everything that you need for worship. We will be having communion, so make sure that you have your finest china for a glass of wine or juice and a plate with bread or cracker on it. And one more thing that you don't normally use to prepare, during the sermon, I'm going to have you write something down. So however you want to write something down, do you need pencil or pen or paper, or you're going to get it on your iPad, but I'm going to have you write something down during the sermon, so you might want to prepare for that. If you need to pause the video and get those supplies ready, go right ahead and do that, and then we will continue in worship. Let us worship together in this way to give thanks and praise to our God of abundance and love. Thank you.
My heart to fear and grieve. like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
A reading from Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. I would recommend for you to read Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11 together. It's Paul's angst about the people of Israel who are not followers of Jesus Christ, and for the connection between that and the Gentiles. Romans 9, verses 1 through 5. I'm speaking the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and uneasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred, according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. For our family activity today, I'm going to choose to use some goldfish crackers. You could use just about anything that has a lot of it, crackers or raisins or Skittles or M&Ms, but I'm choosing goldfish crackers because it goes along with our gospel reading for today. In the gospel reading, Jesus is assembled with a large number of people, 5,000 men, probably 10,000 or more people, and he has to feed them dinner. Now, he only has 5 loaves and 2 fish, and the disciples are worried that this won't be enough. But what we discover in this gospel story is that God always provides enough. So here's what I'd have you to do. Take goldfish or whatever else that you're going to have and give each person in your group 3 goldfish, except for one person. One person, don't give them anything. If you have 4 or 5 people, this works out very, very well. So everybody gets 3 goldfish. You tell them you can do whatever you want with the goldfish. Now, if you eat a goldfish, you do not get anything in return. If you give away a goldfish, you get 2 more. And play several rounds of this. See how it feels to people when they get nothing. See how it feels to people when they receive back after giving to someone. Know that they will always have enough. You will always have enough for yourself. And you will always be provided more to give to somebody else. This is how God blesses us. He blesses us. He gives to us. He cares for us. And he says, if I have given to you, I want you to be a blessing to other people. Because as I've given to you, you should give to others. And guess what? There will always be enough. In fact, there will be always more than enough. So try this game with some goldfish or some other items of food, Skittles or crackers or M&Ms or whatever. There will always be more than enough.
Longing for thy
The Gospel according to Matthew, Matthew 14, 13 through 21. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." "We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said, and he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, gave thanks, broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. Then the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. Some of you know that I often go to visit my mentor, Chaplain Dick Camp. He lives over near Sarasota on the west coast of Florida. And when I go and visit, his wife, Virgin, takes very, very good care of me. I went to visit a couple of weeks ago, and my wife said to me, "Is it ever a burden to you? Do you think they're ever bothered that you are there and they have to provide for you?" And I say, "No." Virgin loves to cook. In fact, I would say that food is one of her love languages. She loves to feed people. She has always been the consummate hostess as long as I have known her. One of the things that most cadets would remember is going up to their house and having Virgin fix a meal, especially a Sunday brunch after church in the cadet chapel. And whenever I go to visit, she will always be asking me, "Rick, can I fix you something? Would you like a muffin? Would you like a cup of coffee? Would you like more food?" Food is her love language. And you know, I think food is also God's love language. God loves to feed his people. And the story we hear about Matthew of the feeding of the 5,000 is God demonstrating this love language by feeding this large crowd. Now, I think it's helpful for us to understand the setting. What brought Jesus to this moment where it was necessary to feed over 10,000 people? Well, what we don't hear in the gospel reading is what happened just before this verse is that Jesus heard the news that his cousin, his predecessor, John the Baptist, the baptizer, had been executed. And he was sad. And he was full of grief. And he wanted to get away. He just needed to be alone. Anybody who has experienced this sort of deep grief very close to you. You know how filled with emotion he must have been, how hurt he must have been, and he just needed to recover. So he decides to go off to a distant place, a deserted place, a wilderness. But the people find out about this, the people find out where he has gone, and they follow him there. And then there's something very significant. It says, Jesus had compassion on them, splenctha. He had a gut reaction. He physically felt their need for healing, their need for teaching, their need to know the love of God. And so he spent that time with them. He cared for them. He healed them. And it became very, very late in the day, and the disciples came to him and said, Lord, we're in a very remote place, and it's getting dark. It's late. It's dinner time. And there's no way that we can feed all these people. Let's send them home so that they can get something to eat. Now, kind of a curious detail I would have about this is there were families here. Now, if you took your family out to a remote place and you knew there were no McDonald's on the way, wouldn't you bring a bad lunch or something? But yet, the disciples' experience of this is that they are lacking food. Send them home. Jesus says, no. No, we don't need to send them home. You give them something to eat. And the disciples said, we don't have anything to give them. All we have are 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And in fact, we hear from the Gospel of John that they didn't bring it. A boy brought it. Can you imagine that? A young boy bringing 5 loaves and 2 fish and willing to give it up so that the disciples might have something. So the disciples turn to Jesus and say, what are we to do? And Jesus takes the bread and the fish, and he lifts them up to heaven, and he blesses them, and he gives them to the disciples, and they give it to the people, and there is enough. No, there's more than enough. Everyone is satisfied, and after everyone has had their fill, they gather up 12 baskets of leftovers. There are only 2 stories that are written in all 4 Gospels. This story, the story of the feeding of the 5,000, and the story of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. This is a very significant story because this story tells us that God provides. The Lord provides more than enough to bless people. The Lord is going to provide more than enough for us to be a blessing to those around us. The Lord is going to provide more than enough for us to do what he has called us to do. If God wants us to feed 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish, we will have enough. And in this church, we are a blessing to our community. We are giving away food as I am speaking this sermon here at our Advent Suntree location. And as we give it away so that these people might be satisfied, more food comes in so that there is more than enough. So I believe that there's a way in which food is one of the love languages of God. This is what he does. He provides food for his people. And we see this throughout Scripture. Some of the more famous Old Testament stories of this, of course, the most famous story is of the people of Israel when they were fleeing Egypt and they were headed to the promised land and they were in a desert. They were in a wilderness. And God provided for them manna, bread, quail for meat, water from a rock, more than enough. And all the people gathered this food and they were satisfied. And there's another story in the book of 1 Kings chapter 17. The prophet Elijah had already spoken to the people and said that there's going to be no rain. So if there's no rain, there's no harvest. And so he flees to the town of Zarephath. And he meets there a widow and he says to the widow, please give me something to drink. Give me some bread to eat. And this widow says to her, sir, I only have a little bit of meal and a little bit of oil. And I'm going to prepare some bread for me and for my son. And after that, it is likely that we are going to die. And Elijah reassures her and says, go ahead, prepare the bread, bring me some, and the Lord will provide. And day after day, that little bit of meal and that little bit of oil continue to provide for her, for her son, and for Elijah. Our God provides more than enough for all that we need. Elijah was succeeded by a man named Elisha, another prophet. And there is a story about him in 2 Kings chapter 4, in which he was in a deserted place, and a man came to bring an offering of bread and grain, and Elisha said, feed the people. And the man said, if I feed the people, there will not be enough. This won't last. And Elisha said, feed the people. And after you feed the people, there will be leftovers. And so the man was astounded, and he fed all of the people. And sure enough, there were leftovers. There was more than enough. We were reminded of this same theme in the New Testament. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10, it said, he who supplies seed for the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and will increase your harvest of righteousness. And in Philippians chapter 4, verse 18, Paul writes to the church in Philippi and says, you have given me this great gift and I am satisfied. And my God will satisfy your every need through the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. There's two points that I want to emphasize about this story. The compassion of God is endless, and the provision of God is endless. The compassion of God is endless. God cares for his people. God loves his people. God has compassion for his people. God wants his people to know his blessing. There's a hymn that I love, The Love of God, and the one stanza goes like this. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the sky of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. The compassion of God is endless. And the provision of God is endless. The Psalms tell us that he owns the cattle on a thousand hills. God continues to provide for his people through harvest, through sun, through rain, through all of the abundance of the earth. God's provisions are endless. God has provided everything that we need for life and godliness, and he gives to us more and more. And so we who are followers of Jesus Christ, we have received this compassion. We have received this provision. And so we, like the disciples with Jesus who were given the blessed bread and fish, ought to give to others and know that there will always be more than enough. More than enough to be a blessing to our community. This was what God has given to us. All right, here's where the pen and paper or whatever you're going to write, however you're going to write, comes in. Let's begin with the disciples' point of view. They received this bread and this fish. They had that, and they were to give it away. Now, I want you to write down, what do you have that somebody else needs? What is it that you could give away to satisfy somebody's physical need, their hunger, or an emotional need, or a spiritual need? Do you have time? Can you have a conversation? Can you send a note? How has God blessed you? What is it that you can do to be a blessing to somebody else? Write that down. Write that down right now. And I want you to look at it later on, because I'm going to pray that God will help you find a way to be that blessing to somebody else. And as you give it away, know that our God of abundance will continue to provide for you. Now, the second thing I want you to write down is, imagine you're from the people's point of view. You're in a deserted place. It's late in the day. You're hungry. You have no food. Perhaps during this pandemic, you're thinking, I'm lonely. I wish for connections with people. The second thing I want you to write down is, what do you need that somebody else could supply? What way in which somebody could come alongside you and provide for you? What is it that you need? And my prayer for you is that God will show a way for this provision to be given to you sometime very, very soon. Because our God's compassion is endless, and our God's provision is endless. I said to you that Virgin, my mentor's wife, her love language is food. But unfortunately, my mentor doesn't eat much anymore. He is in the last stages of suffering from Parkinson's disease. So she can no longer feed him with food, but she can express her love to him and care for him. And I said to you that perhaps food is the love language of God. Why? Because food sustains life. And what really is the love language of God is life. And he gives to us life. And this story in the Gospel of John, immediately following Jesus, declares that he himself is the bread of heaven. And so we are filled with the bread of heaven, and he gives us this life, this abundant life now, and this life eternal. So let us always remember that as God has given to us, God has blessed us, know that there will always be more than enough for us to be a blessing to those around us. Amen.
sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God.
Let us pray. God of compassion and love and abundance, you have given us so much. You've given us life. You've given us love. You've given us community. You've given us provisions. Open our eyes so that we might see the ways in which we may be a blessing to those around us. There are some that are even gathered here tonight that are feeling like they are in a deserted place. They are in a wilderness, and they are hungry and alone. May we have your eyes of compassion. May we see them the way you see them and provide for them. Lord, may we see all of creation as your bounty, as your abundance, and care for it. Care for the land, care for the water, care for the sky. Care for every aspect of your creation. We pray that you will work in us and through us so that we might be your agents of love and life. We especially ask you to care for those who are dealing with sickness or sadness, with grief or distress. God of endless compassion, comfort them now. And may we know now and always, that you have provided for us, through Christ our Lord, life and love forever and ever. Amen. We celebrate in this meal God's compassion and his provision. We express with this bread and this cup, this wine, God's love and the bread of heaven through Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." And as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death, resurrection, and ascension until he comes again. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you for the privilege of being able to worship with you, especially in this interesting way and these interesting times. I'm going to give the announcements. I know during the contemporary service when we were at in-person worship, Josh Pulver would do this with quite a flair. Now you're going to get it in Pastor Rick's style. We have daily devotions and sermons. We are getting into the world of podcasts. We are posting sermons, and starting August 3rd, Pastor Jeremy will have daily devotions Monday through Friday. Go to our website to learn more at adventbrevard.org. On Sunday, August 23rd, from 9 a.m. noon till noon at our Suntree campus, we will be blessing all students, teachers, administrators, school employees, and families for the new school year. People will stay in their cars and drive through as Pastor Jeremy and Joy give a blessing. They will also be handing out an inspirational backpack book bag tag for anyone who wants one. Advent's annual meeting has been pushed back from Sunday, August 30th. The Congregation Council has not decided on a new date yet. This will be discussed at our next Congregational Council meeting on Monday, August 17th. Thank you for those who have continued to support our ministry. Many of you have done this by going online at our website and donating there. You may also donate by mailing your contributions here to the church office. We do appreciate it. It is wonderful to see your support and generosity for the work that we are doing for the kingdom of God. And now let us receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
This song has motions to it, and so we're going to let Pastor Jeremy lead us in the motions, because nobody does it like Pastor Jeremy does. Is everybody ready? Followers of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the world, go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God, and we will.
You came from heaven to earth to show.